I own a 3040T Chinese CNC machine. I mentioned in my last video that after about 50 hours of use, the spindle stopped working. In this video, I'm going to be tearing down the spindle to find out what went wrong. Whether or not I can solve the issue, I've decided to upgrade to a 1.5 kilowatt spindle in VFD. This will give me a little bit more power to play with, as I found the 400 watt spindle that came with the router is lacking. I made a video showing how to set up the new spindle in VFD, and I'll put a card for that here. With that said, here's where we're at. Just before it failed, I was in the process of facing a new spoilboard. I was using a 3/4 inch router bit feeding at 50 inches per minute with a 20 thou depth of cut on the worst side of the board. Since I was doing this by hand, the step over varied from probably 50% to 75%. Now, this is a pretty large router bit for this 400 watt spindle, and I knew that going in. It's actually not hard to stall this setup with a 1/4 inch end mill, but I didn't let that little detail bother me because there's some kind of overcurrent protection in the system. I know that because I tripped it. Anyway, there are two possibilities. Either the spindle is damaged or the power supply burnt out. If you watch the spindle closely here, you can see that every time I turn the power on, the spindle starts to spin, then stops at the same spot. So I measured the runout, and at half a thou, there's no obvious physical damage to the spindle. In fact, that's way better than I thought the spindle was to begin with. This could be a sign that there's something electrically wrong inside the spindle that's causing it to short in the same point in its rotation every time, and that's tripping the overcurrent protection in the motor controller. So I've taken the spindle apart. The first thing that jumps out at me here is how the bearings are held in place. In both the drive end and commutator covers, there's a soft boot between the bearing and the cover. And as if that weren't bad enough, even with the boot in place, the bearings fit so loosely that it makes me wonder how I can even measure a half thou runout on this. The shaft is practically floating. My guess is that the runout under load is going to be huge. In the lamb stacks themselves, you can see that it's been balanced fairly cleanly, which is nice. And really, the spindle itself doesn't produce much vibration. The majority of the vibration actually comes from the fan, which was, when I got it, slip fit onto the shaft and held in place by a loose retaining ring. The first mod I actually did for this spindle was to remove those retaining rings, drive a set screw in from the side, and then rebalance the fan, which is why you see all those holes. And yeah, that's going to mess with the efficiency of the fan, but I don't think that's what happened here. Another thing that I see that I don't like are the bearings themselves. Both the bearings are the same part number, just some generic shielded bearing. I'd like to see sealed bearings in here given the amount of dust they'll be exposed to, but honestly, I didn't expect that for something this cheap. I did expect, however, that they would at least use a larger bearing on the drive end. If you spin the drive end bearing, you can already feel that it's starting to give out, whereas the comm end is still buttery smooth. What I'd like to see is a large bearing on the drive end, where it's going to take the most force, and either a smaller ball bearing or a roller bearing on the comm end, since it'll be under less load. The roller bearing can actually serve double duty. As the shaft heats up, it's going to want to expand, and if there's a roller bearing on the comm end and the ball bearing press fit into the drive end, then the shaft can expand inside of the motor, leaving the tool at the same Z height, because the shaft is free to move axially in the roller bearing. Now this spindle accounts for any shaft movement or tolerance with a wave spring on the drive end. The problem is that this means that any shaft expansion or downforce from the tool is going to decrease your Z height. Realistically, that change is going to be far less than whatever play there is in the cheap Y linear bearings. But I bought some adjustable bearings to replace those with soon, so I'll also make a video and put a link in the description down below. And if I forget to add that link, just check my channel. While we're talking about the durability of the spindle, I'd like to see varnish on the magnet wire, and I'd like to see epoxy where the commutator segments connect to the coil. Right now, those connections, they aren't even soldered, they're just crimped. And so what's going to happen here is, as the copper wires in the armature vibrate as the armature spins, they're going to work hardened over time, and it's going to lead to them snapping. So that'll be one failure mode, but I think that your bearings in this case are probably going to give out first, and at that point, I mean, it's just worthwhile throwing away the spindle. On the commutator itself, there's the first hint at a problem. After 50 hours of use, I expected to see well-formed traces of brush material on the commutator, but the traces I see here are much narrower than the width of the brushes, and the leading edge of each commutator segment is burnt. But it's only burnt right at the top of where the brushes contact. Looking closely at the brushes, you can see why. Only a tiny part of the brush is making contact. It looks like they cut a chamfer by hand to make it easier to assemble, but even that doesn't make sense since the brush holders have this nice little feature to hold the brushes back while you're putting it together. For a given current and area, you can calculate current density. The current density is inversely related to the area, meaning that the smaller the contact area, the higher the current density. If the current density is too high in a brush, it can cause sparking and it can cause the commutator to be burnt like this. We know that this is a problem. As for the lack of traces, that points to brush springs that are too light. If the burns in the commutator left a film that increased the resistance as well, that, in combination with the reduced area and the light brush springs, explains why the spindle wasn't performing even as well as I thought it should. So, what I'm gonna do is resurface the commutator with some 220 grit sandpaper. I also sanded the brushes to roughly the shape of the commutator and put it all back together. Now for the moment of truth. After a little messing around, the motor started spinning even when the spindle was supposed to be off. So it looks like I probably should have torn this down the first time that I tripped the overcurrent. And it's possible there is no overcurrent protection and I was just shorting something. Nice. Well, thanks for watching. Time to install the new spindle.